were talking about Iran, said no politician in the last year. As some of you regular viewers may know, I check in on Iran more than most of my extended family. To, you know, just see how America's maximum pressure campaign is going. This week, in a hard-to-celebrate foreign policy victory, Iran has descended into massive protests in more than 100 cities after the government could no longer afford to make payments on a major fuel subsidy. Woohoo? In the spirit of impeachment, I thought I'd talk about the leader removal process in a country whose impeachment proceedings are hit the street and start setting things on fire. First, a little bit of background though. If you look at Iran's exports, well, they're about as diverse as a 90s sitcom. So when America said any country that bought oil from Iran would be sanctioned, well, that just shrunk their exports by 72%. Now this wasn't an isolated experience. For the past 2 years, we've been doing the linguistically impossible and escalating maximum pressure. Specifically, sanctioning more and more Iranian industries and using the threat of sanctions to get other countries involved. Alright, sure. The last round of sanctions were maximum pressure. Now it's maximum mer pressure. Still not doing it? Alright, ludicrous pressure time. These oil sanctions were the tipping points though. The crude oil exports on which Iran relies for much of its hard currency earnings have fallen up to about 2,500 barrels a day from a peak of 2.5 million barrels a day in April last year. That has made unaffordable the $69 billion that Iran spent on energy subsidies in 2018. So with this context, what's going on in Iran and how does it affect the larger region of the Middle East?
6 days on, internet service in Iran's mostly remains in the dark, a sudden cut in fuel subsidies sparking an immediate backlash in a nation already crippled by sanctions. Images like this one of protesters cheering as a building goes up in flames.
The first thing I need to clarify is, and most of you have probably already gotten this idea, but this fuel subsidy was a pretty big deal. Petrol arouses passions in Iran like no other commodity. Iran has some of the world's most heavily subsidized petrol. The refined stuff costs less than crude and less even than bottled water. Cheaper than water. Maybe in a few years Iran will have to start a war for clean water. Of course, this means that every time you fill your tank, the government is shelling out quite a bit of cash. The end of this fuel subsidy isn't happening in isolation though. Iran state revenue is down 70% from what they were expecting it to be, because they own a ton of businesses that can no longer sell things internationally. And it's not a good sign when your primary revenue source today is Sharia-compliant government debt issued through the People's Bank of China. So Iran's putting most of their short-term spending on a geopolitical credit card. At the same time, there's a cash crisis going on. The fall in the rial's value and soaring inflation have sharply cut the purchasing power of public sector workers. So with that combination of the state no longer being able to afford subsidies and prices going up naturally because of a weak currency, well, it has been a double whammy on the lower middle class. So what has happened as a result of this? Well, a few things. First, the pretty unpleasant elephant in the room.
Amnesty International says that so far, at least 106 people have been killed.
We believe that the real number may be much higher, given that there is now a total or a near total block on access to the internet.
Yeah, it's terrible. There's definitely a substantial cost to protesting in Iran. Bigger picture though, the Iranian government has congealed a bit in response to these protests. The various branches of Iran's government, often at odds, have closed ranks behind a newly formed Supreme Council of Economic Coordination, which signed the decision to raise prices. Quick side note, Iran, you have to cool it with making everything supreme. I can buy your supreme leader a thesaurus if that would help. Your constitution is starting to read more like a douche's closet or a Taco Bell menu. Now this consolidation of the legislative, executive, and to a certain extent judicial branches in a council of economic coordination has people expecting that this government isn't going anywhere. Especially because, unlike Bolivia, where then-President Evo Morales fled to Mexico after the army chief called on him to resign, there's no sign that Iran's rulers are losing the support of the Iranian Revolutionary Guard Corps, or the besieged militias that were deployed to crush much wider anti-government demonstrations in 2009. To be fair though, while your explanation for your government being stable is, we still have the military on our side, generally not a great sign, especially when parliamentary elections are next year. So this leads to what I would describe as the core of this episode, because some of you are probably asking, well, if the government's gonna stay in power, why are you taking the time to talk about this issue? I mean, I've only seen 100 impeachment inquiry summaries. You could have been the 101st. Well, I chose this story for two reasons. First, because Iran did the gas subsidy reform because they're broke. People can't afford a 300% increase in gas prices, but the regime didn't have any other choice. Equally importantly though, this event is not happening in isolation.
Tonight in Baghdad, security services killed at least two and wounded hundreds of protesters who are challenging the very foundation of the government. Meanwhile, in Lebanon, there is a caretaker government today after the prime minister resigned yesterday.
All right, so what do protests in Iraq and Lebanon have to do with what we're talking about today? Well, in what feels like a first for me, people in the Middle East are mad, but not at America. Feels good. In recent weeks, Iraq and Lebanon and Iran have been beset by demonstrations that are, at least in part, opposing Tehran. Now to summarize these incredibly complex protests in about 2 minutes, Lebanon and Iraq are both frustrated with Iran's incredibly strong influence in their countries. Luckily for me, someone did pretty much all of the research for me on this issue. About a week ago we saw,
leaked by an Iraqi whistleblower that outlined the extent of Iran's influence in Iraq. The documents are dated between 2014 and 2015 and provide insight into Tehran's alleged interference in Iraqi politics.
Again, a ton to unpack there. I mean, that's an episode on its own. More than 700 pages of leaks. Main point is, Iraq's leading political, military, and security officials have had secret special relationships with Iran, including Iraq's Prime Minister Abdel Mahdi. In this case, Iran had a dual goal of weakening Iraq so that it couldn't be a regional threat anymore, and keeping the right people in power in order to get the outcomes they wanted. As you can imagine, this is not something you want to hear if you were to, say, live in Iraq or Lebanon. You'd probably prefer to hear, hey, my government is acting with my best interests in mind. Of course, elephant in the room on this one, I'm American, and while I'm enjoying this great view from my glass house of Iranian influence falling apart a bit, I probably shouldn't go casting too many stones. So Iran's having a large internal protest because the state is broke, and their Middle East client states are starting to have equally large protests because they want a government that represents the people of that country. This all brings us to the huge worry and kind of pinnacle of this episode. If you think all this sounds like a recipe for just an ultra-violent Iranian intervention that the US might not be prepared to respond to, well, you're not alone. As Politico reports, it's all creating a pivotal moment for US policy towards Iran, but thus far has gotten little attention back in the US, where foreign policy specialists of all political stripes fear the Trump administration and Congress are too consumed by an impeachment inquiry in the 2020 election. What? Only focusing on impeachment in the election? That doesn't sound like us. Basically, Iran's relationship with the Middle East is coming to a tipping point in a way that could be beneficial if we play our cards right. But they're playing poker, and we're playing Uno. There's no affirmative US policy in the region, and what we do is largely based on reaction right now. The Trump administration's special envoy overseeing the coalition to fight ISIS, Brett McGurk, recently said, "There's a real risk that over the coming months, Iran does something in the Gulf, or elsewhere, and you have no deliberative routine process of which the president's been a part of to assess courses of action. That means a unilateral reaction not considered policy in a moment of crisis." If only Iran had scheduled their instability for, you know, about a year ago when any Americans cared. I guess the basic crux of this episode is me waving my hands and saying, "Hey guys, maximum pressure seems to have worked. Iran's hurting right now. Mission accomplished." Now, what next? Thank you, and that's definitely not all I have to say about that. Hello YouTube, I'd like to thank my patrons for helping me put out my videos. If you want to support independent, nonpartisan news looking into the overlooked, join this growing group of exceptional individuals by clicking that link in the description. Also, remember to subscribe. If I can get 1,000 of you, I can put the Patreon icon up as an icon itself. Wouldn't that just be beautiful? Ring that bell so that freedom can continue to ring, and give me a thumbs up if you like what you saw. Lastly, as always, thank you for watching.